Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it together. It's great to be together in God's house, surrounded by the fellowship of believers here, and not just here, but scattered throughout the world, right? As we come in truth and honor to worship our God and receive His good gifts through His Word, we're going to be focusing on our gospel reading today from Luke chapter 14, hearing how we might go about living our lives in the midst of the Sabbath day and being healed for it. So that's what we'll be focusing on in the sermon today. I hope and pray that this is a blessing for you as we worship together. And so let us join together in singing our opening hymn, Beautiful Savior. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? The Spirit of God calls forth sacrifices pleasing to God. We still make sacrifices today with things like brotherly love, hospitality to strangers, care for those who are in need, faithfulness in marriage and the family, fearless joy in the Lord, right faith, and right worship. However, often because of our sinful state, we neglect the Spirit's power to have free course in our life. So, let us join together and ask God to be gracious and merciful to us. Almighty God, we confess to you that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Alone we remain without hope, health, and help. Have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins. And lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Together, you have confessed your sins, but God does not hold them against you because he has sent his Son to proclaim the good news to those who are spiritually poor. So it is in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ that I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord of grace and mercy, teach us by your Holy Spirit to follow the example of your Son in true humility, that we may withstand the temptations of the devil and with pure hearts and minds avoid ungodly pride. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading comes from Proverbs chapter 25, where we see a way of humility forward that God gives us wisdom for in our lives as we go about them. It is the glory of God to conceal a matter. To search out a matter is the glory of kings. As the heavens are high and the earth is deep, so the hearts of kings are unsearchable. Remove the dross from the silver, and out comes material for the silversmith. Remove the wicked from the king's presence, and his throne will be established through righteousness. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among great men. It is better for him to say to you, "Come up here," than for him to humiliate you before a nobleman. What you have seen with your eyes, do not bring hastily to court, for what will you do in the end if your neighbor puts you to shame? If you argue your case with a neighbor, do not betray another man's confidence, or he who hears it may shame you, and you will never lose your bad reputation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Epistle, Hebrews 13, 1 through 17, pages 11, 94 in your Bible. Keep on loving each other as brothers. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing some people have entertained angels without knowing. Remember those in prison as if they were fellow prisoners, and those who are mistreated as if you were mistreated or suffering. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Keep your lives free from the love of money and the content with what you have, because God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." For we say with confidence, "The Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of the way of life and the intimate of their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by ceremonial foods, which are of no value to those who eat them. We have an altar from which those who are ministered and the tabernacles which have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of the animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have the enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer good sacrifices of praise, the fruit of the lips, and to confess his name. And do not forget to good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. Obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. Obey them so that their work will be joy, not a burden, for that they would be no advantage to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The verse, Alleluia. Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Alleluia. Today we hear a parable about the wedding feast and the great banquet, and also Jesus healing a man who is there on the Sabbath day. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. There, in front of him, behold, was a man suffering from dropsy. Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him away. Then he asked them, "If one of you has a son or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out?" And they had nothing to say. When he noticed how the guests picked places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, "Give this man your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes to you, he will say, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Then Jesus said to the host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends and your brothers or relatives or rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we sing our hymn of the day together. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It's good to be here together today as we hear God's word. And the gospel reading today reminds me of one of my history teachers in high school. He had a phrase all the time where he would say, "Repetition is retention." He'd say it over and over. In fact, he'd have us as a class say it, "Repetition is retention." And we despise that phrase, even though he gave it to us as a comfort when we had to memorize dates and facts and people. All the time he'd say, "Repetition is retention." I think it was his way of kind of getting at, you know, the phrase that you've probably heard before. You know, those who forget history are doomed to repeat it, right? Yeah, so he wanted us to remember, to retain the good things and the facts of history. So we'd practice over and over. And we've seen things like that in our lives, right? With confirmation, right? It's not just young people who bemoan memory work. We have all been there, right? Where we've said, "I don't want to memorize anymore," right? Or maybe it's happened to us when you've had a parent or a spouse who constantly is reminding you of that one thing that needs to get done. Repetition is retention. If you get it done, then you don't have to remember it anymore. It happens all throughout our life, and we're constantly reminded of things. But when you have something repeated over and over and over in your life, like Everly, go sit down. Well, sometimes it falls on deaf ears. That can happen to us in our lives very easily, and not just with things like memorizing history facts or getting something done at home that we're being nagged about. Our gospel reading gives us today an insight into the lives of God's people from the time of the Old Testament up to the Pharisees, and how the Pharisees got to a point where they had heard things over and over and over, and what it did to their lives when they heard Jesus' words. And it gives us a moment to pause as God's church today, to look at how we live. So you know, the Israelites have been God's people from the time that he called Abraham forth from his family and he gave him a promise. He said that I will make you a great people, a great nation. They'll be as numerous as the stars and the sands of the sea. And that promise continued. God's people heard his word, that promise that was given to Abraham, and they grew into a great nation. A great nation that ultimately ended up in slavery, with Moses being their deliverer. And God gave them another promise as he spoke his word to them and said to them that I will be your God and you will be my people. I will be your God and you will be my people. And Moses brings them the law to define their relationship with God. You remember the Ten Commandments, the movie, right? Right? Where Charlton Heston goes up on the mountain and he sees God's finger writing on the tablets. It defines their relationship with God. Here's how you are to be with me. So they're constantly in dialogue with God and how he expects them to live. They heard God's word brought to them by Moses through the law. And then you have the time of the judges and the king, and this people get organized and gathered together. They form a community, a culture. And it seems like things are going so well. And then God sends prophets to speak to them, to interpret the law for them, and continue to bring them God's promises in the midst of their lives so that they would hear it over and over and over again. so that God would call them to repentance through the prophets and also to faith to that promise that they were given. In the Old Testament, you can see that God is knitting together generation upon generation upon generation upon generation for hundreds of years, over and over, God is knitting them together as his people. And isn't that something that we yearn for today? You can see it all around. Young and old alike here in the church yearn for that knitting together. The younger people desire to have people their age, right, coming to church, spending time with them so that they have someone who's going through similar experiences in life that they can share in with. And yet so often when we come, it's as if we're alone. And yet when you see people your same age, you're kind of scared to get to know them. The elderly here desire the same thing, right? To see the hope of the church continuing for future generations. To know that all the time and effort that they've spent in their lives, that you've spent in your life, will not be all for vain. That generations to come will hear God's word, be his people, and God will be their God. We desire that. Both young and old alike, that passing on from the next generation to the next generation. And we do it in many different ways, just like Israel did it. They had a detailed, intricate system to make sure that they passed on, not just culture and community, but their confession of faith in who their God was. All sorts of different things. But you know, at times when you hear something over and over and over again, sometimes it can do things to your body that you don't expect. It can cause your ears to go a little dull. It can cause your heart to be a little hardened, especially if you hear something that you don't quite exactly like or you're not quite exactly sure about, and you're not quite sure who you can talk to about it. Which is why we need to pay close attention to the situation that Jesus finds himself in when he's invited to the house of the Pharisees. Jesus is brought there that day by a ruler of the Pharisees, welcomed into his home. And not just on any particular day. It's not just as if he says, hey, why don't you come on over to my house later this afternoon? No, it's the Sabbath meal. From Friday evening to Saturday evening, Jesus is invited to partake in the meal after Sabbath so that they would share in that together. And there Jesus is being watched. Have you ever been in a place where you felt like you were being watched? How uncomfortable can it make you when you feel like you're living in fear of doing the wrong thing, of saying the wrong thing, or even being the wrong thing? And yet Jesus doesn't live in fear of what these Pharisees might do and say to him. In fact, he's actually looking out for people who are afraid of what the Pharisees might do. And there, lo and behold, right in front of him is a man who's experiencing dropsy. I don't know if you've ever seen anybody with a disease like this, but dropsy is where your body fills up with fluids, your joints swell up, you are in extreme pain constantly. In one of our translations, it just says that there in front of Jesus was a man who had great amounts of swelling. Other translations actually have the word in Greek, it's behold, right there in front of Jesus, bam, there's this man who's suffering physically on a day that God set aside from Genesis chapter 1 for rest. And he can't have that rest because he is experiencing physical pain and suffering. A day that God always intended for mankind to rest in. You remember, days 1 through 6, God created, and it was good. Humankind was very good. And on the 7th day, he rested. He rested so that we would be healed from the rest of our work that we did through the rest of the week. And there Jesus is in the midst of the Pharisees, and they're watching him. And as they watch him, Jesus turns to them and he says, "Is it lawful on the Sabbath to be healed or not?" If we were there at the feast on that Sabbath day, we would raise our hands and say, "It's obvious. It is so obvious to be healed, right?" But we probably wouldn't want to be in the one that goes and does the healing, would we? For fear of what they might say, for how they might criticize. Maybe instead we'd pull one of these tricks where we sit back and we know the answer, but we're too afraid to say, and so we just start humming the Jeopardy theme song, waiting for the Pharisees to answer. We know it's obvious. The Sabbath is a day to be healed, to rest. But it's a tough question for the Pharisees because of what they have heard over and over and over again, what they've been teaching over and over and over again. That's why no one speaks up except for Jesus, who wants this man to be healed and experience what it is like to have a rest on the Sabbath day. The Pharisees want to honor the Sabbath day, but they only want to do that because they think that it's what they have to do. Right? We honor the Sabbath day because it's what God told us to do. We do it because that's what we do. Instead of hearing and being moved to love like God has called them to. For us, at a time when it seems like the church is shrinking, when it's unpopular to live as a true Christian, when it's more popular to change what God says so that other people might be welcomed in and not feel bad, it's hard. It's hard. Because we think that in order to bring those people in, we have to do what we think is necessary to ensure that the next generation will hear and believe and have that faith that we've had throughout our lives. In order to get our friends to come, we have to change what God says. It's a good thing to care about the passing on of the faith. That's what the Pharisees were worried about. They were caring about the people, but so much so because they had to. We go to the Sabbath because it's what we do. They practiced being Jews by what they had to do rather than by hearing what God had done for them throughout their lives. When you rest in what God has done through Jesus Christ in you, for you, you will find healing. Here in Luke 14, we see that Jesus came to do for those people who are physically suffering, that he wanted to do for them what God intended for us to have in creation, healing. Jesus healed on the Sabbath, the day of rest, church, Sunday morning for them, Friday evening to Saturday evening. Jesus healed on the Sabbath because it is about what God does for us. That's different than telling people, well, you know, you really should just come to church because it's what we do. It's what we've always done. Well, guess what? They've heard that over and over and over. And sometimes repetition is not retention. Think about all the people that are suffering physically. Not out in the world, some person that you're imagining that's suffering. Think about all the people in our community that you might know who are suffering physically. I mean, you can just look at our prayer list, right? And see all the people who are connected to this place, whether as members or as friends or as family. You can see lots of people physically suffering. Then you think about, maybe you think about those who are suffering spiritually that aren't written down. Maybe it's those of you gathered here today wondering, is this day, is this 1 hour out of the 7 days of the week, is this 1 hour a place where I can be healed? It's a good question. Are you here wondering out of fear what to do, what to say, who to talk to? Well, if you are, come and see Jesus, because he looks and he sees, and behold, here are people who are in need of a doctor, who are sick. Jesus isn't just teaching us about prayer in Luke 14. He's in the middle of the action, right there in the middle of that meal on that Sabbath day, looking at the man who needs to be healed so that he can have the Sabbath for rest. And Jesus shows us that he himself came to show what we need to hear over and over and over again, that this day is for us to be healed. Forgiveness is about us being healed and what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. When he took all sins upon the cross, when he took all physical pain upon his own body, and he gave his life for the whole world, for you, so that you would know when you walk in these doors, this is a place of healing. A place where Christ bears your wounds upon his body. When sins are done against you, you bring them here and you lay them at the foot of the cross and you say, God, I don't know where else to take these pains. And we pray for things like medicine and science to work, but when those things don't work, you realize and recognize that it's not just physically that you need healing, but spiritually. The body is not disconnected from the soul, and Jesus wanted this man to know that when he's healed, the Sabbath is for him spiritually as well. So maybe today you've experienced just a little healing. Maybe it's your heart that was hardening over and over when you heard things over and over and over, and your ears were growing a little dull and needed a little healing. Maybe there were some calluses that were growing and the word was seeking to get in there and to heal it. And I hope that you experience the healing that Jesus offers here on this Sabbath day, this Sabbath rest. Because what Jesus wants us to hear over and over, not just this day, but every Sabbath day, is that these are words of respite. Like Hebrews 13 says, never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. So that we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? That sounds like someone who has been healed. It sounds like a Christian who is healthy, who is not afraid of a dying church, but sees the church as a place for dying people. And there are many who we see day by day, not just physically, who need to be healed by the Holy Spirit and the means that God works through in the world, but those spiritually and mentally who are tortured. We hear about it over and over and over. We see it over and over, but oftentimes we don't see that they're sitting right in front of us because we're afraid of what they might say. We're afraid to ask and reach out. But what does Jesus do? He sees you and I sitting in front of him. He sees the man with dropsy sitting right in front of him, and he goes into action so that he might have the Sabbath. He heals him. So be healed today. Keep your eyes and ears that have been healed here today, keep them looking out for those who need this Sabbath day of healing and rest. For it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. And Jesus has healed us here. And he will continue to heal us over and over again. Because repetition is retention. When we come and repeat the forgiveness that God gives to us and he repeats it to us, our bodies begin to retain it. Our souls begin to retain it so that we can repeat it to others. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, keep and guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand as we have the joy and honor of repeating and confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess together. I believe in God the Father, and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for all the goodness and loving kindness you have bestowed on us, especially for redeeming us through the great sacrifice of the death and resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and for giving us the gift of true repentance, faith, hope, and love by your Holy Spirit. Work in us a right understanding of your will and grant us hearts, lips, and lives that show forth true thanksgiving in all we say and do. Lord, in your mercy, guide and govern your church throughout the world that all may walk in the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Send your grace on all ministers of the gospel and upon the congregations committed to their care, that they may please you in all things. Lord, in your mercy, have mercy upon all who are in authority over us, those who keep watch over our souls, as well as those in authority of worldly government, that we may have free course to live as your redeemed people and serve one another in love. Bless all who serve to protect us in our nation and our community. Lord, in your mercy, preserve those who travel and help all who call upon you in any need, especially Wes and Barb Hoyta, Evie Schreiber, who has an upcoming eye surgery, Pastor Travis Leslie, for Melanie Settler, for Dale Holton, cousin of Marion Braylia, for Norma Olson as she continues to heal, for Maya Murray, granddaughter of Lynn and Darlene Murray, for Jane Close, friend of Larry and Joan Lobitz, for Carol Court, sister of Joan Lobitz, for Ron Rogers as he continues to heal and recover, for Wayne Hobbin, for Roberta McBride, mother of Tina Thien. Lord, we give you thanks for the joining of Amanda Reese and Jeremy Turk yesterday as they were joined in holy matrimony and have been united as one flesh. Grant that they may be sustained throughout all their days by your word, that they may enjoy the good fruits of marriage that come through it that you give to us, and also grant that we would support them in all they need for their body and life. Lord, we also pray for any that are on our hearts and our minds at this time. That they may have patience and trust in the midst of suffering and, according to your will, be released from their afflictions. Lord, in your mercy, we remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you in your church on earth, who now rest from their labors. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated, and at this time, we will bring forward our offerings. If you have any offerings still with you, there still will be plates as we close worship today. If you have them with you, you can put them in the offering plates back there. Together, we sing our offertory together.
Oh, sing hallelujah.
Please stand as you are able as we pray the prayer our Lord has taught us. Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we have offered up our praise here this day as a sacrifice to God, he moves us to consider the impact of this holy day. So the third commandment is good to remember, which says,
remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy.
What does this mean?
We should fear and love God, so that we do not despise preaching and his word, but hold it sacred and gladly hear and learn it.
So we learn that God's word is what keeps this day holy, that it may dwell in our heart and mind. How do you keep a day holy?
The day itself does not need to be made holy, for it was created holy, but God wants it to be holy for me. We observe this holy day, not because we have to, but because our bodies need them. Nature teaches and demands that we rest for a day to be refreshed.
You have been refreshed on this holy day through the forgiveness of your sins, and as God has spoken to you for your bodies, to rest from your job and occupations, he uses this day to remind you to occupy yourselves daily with his word. Carry it on your heart and lips. Let God's word dwell in you richly as he blesses you now. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our closing hymn together.
Thank you.
right. So we've got a few announcements this morning. It's good to be together, but we've got lots of things coming up, which is exciting. Confirmation is coming up. The first night will be parent and student night on September 7th. So there will be a parent meeting. So I'll be teaching 7th grade this year, and Gary will be teaching 8th grade this year, which will be great. We've had great helpers in the past, so it's great to get started with confirmation starting up on September 7th. There should have been a letter that went out just recently, so if you didn't get it this week, confirmands and confirmand parents, it should come soon on Monday. Also, September 11th is Rally Sunday, so we'll be kicking off the start of Sunday school, high school youth group. Also, for adult Bible study, we'll wait 1 week to actually start our study. But there's, if you would like to lead a card game over in the fellowship hall or bingo, we have opportunities for that. So there's opportunities to sign up to lead that. Also, on Rally Sunday, we'll have a potluck together. So there's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex by the office window if you want to sign up to bring a main dish, side dish, or dessert. So September 11th, Rally Sunday, we'll have games for all ages, from the youngins to the older kids, and everyone, it'll be great. So bring some food, bring some cards to play, and we'll have some stuff outside and inside. It will be a great, great day. Also, the elders are helping serve that meal. Let's see, Bible study, again, September 18th is when that will start up. And then there are also sheets for signing up for Sunday school and registering for that out on the same table out there. Can anyone think of any other announcements that we have? Two announcements, Greg, and then Joyce.
October 9th.
Yeah, it will be a great time. The Chosen is awesome. The first season is great, and so it'll be good to watch the second season together. Joyce, you had an announcement?
I'm just reminding you of what we do this week, so that if you want any items dropped off, it is Thursday and Friday. So if you want help or donation, prayers, everything will be appreciated. So thank you.
Awesome. Love Inc. is coming up, which will be great. Any other announcements that anyone can think of? All right, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.